my name is Jason Hadley, and today I'm going to be doing a chemistry demonstration involving the extraction of iron from total cereal. For this demo, you're going to need about 250 milligrams of a cereal fortified with iron, and today I'm using total cereal. And then you'll also need a mortar and pestle or something with which you can crush the cereal up. And then a beaker containing approximately 250 milliliters or 500 milliliters of water. And then today I'm using a magnetic stir rod to stir the cereal and water in solution. And I've already stirred this sample up, and I'm going to use a magnet to retrieve the stirred bar. And what you can see on left out is this black powder, and this substance is elemental iron, which has been fortified in the total cereal. So some background on iron. Iron is the most abundant element found within the Earth's crust, and is also the most abundant metal found on Earth. It is in its elemental form when fortified in total cereal, and this means it is Fe with no charge. And about 90% of all the metal that is now fortified across the globe is iron. And this iron in which we use to build metal structures is the same iron found in your total cereal. And why this is important and why this relates to biochemistry is that iron is not only integral to creating physical metal structures, but also chemical structures within our bodies. Why would they be putting iron in our cereal? Iron is an essential micronutrient, which micronutrients are considered vitamins and minerals that we consume in our diets. And iron is in the center of the heme molecule, and the heme molecule is a portion of the hemoglobin protein, which is found on the surface of our red blood cells. And you can see here in the center of this heme molecule is Fe2+. This differs slightly from the elemental iron that is found in total cereal. Fe2+ is also known as ferrous iron, and it carries a positive charge, and it is the key center structural component of the heme molecule. Heme is a non-protein section of the hemoglobin, and hemoglobin is the mechanism by which our bodies transport red blood cells. I retrieved this figure from WikiBook's page on structural and biochemistry. So moving on, more about hemoglobin and iron's role in hemoglobin. Hemoglobin is a globular protein found on the surface of our red blood cells. And you can see in this figure the heme groups in the center, with iron being in the center of those heme groups. And then you can see these polypeptide chains, which represent the globin portion of hemoglobin. And when these sections approximate themselves to each other, they form the hemoglobin molecule. Oxygen carrying capacity is the key function of hemoglobin. According to Lutz, Mazur, and Litch's Nutrition and Diet Therapy, approximately 98.5% of oxygen in the blood is carried on hemoglobin. Hemoglobin is central to the functioning of our red blood cells. And hemoglobin is actually what gives our blood its red color. Anemia is defined as having a low number of red blood cells, or as having a low number of hemoglobin found on the surface of your red blood cells. There are many different types of anemia, and today I'm going to be focusing on iron deficiency anemia. Iron deficiency anemia, per the Mayo Clinic's website, is the most common cause of anemia worldwide, and it is due to a lack of iron available to make the heme molecule, which is an integral portion of the hemoglobin protein. According to the National Heart, Lung, and Blood Institute, in America alone, there's 3 million people suffering from iron deficiency anemia. Why is anemia such an important clinical finding for our patients is because anemia, if prolonged, can lead to hypoxemia. And hypoxemia is defined as having low oxygen saturation in the circulating blood. And when we have low circulating oxygen levels, our tissues are deprived of oxygen. And so really, iron is important, but the key here is the transport of oxygen into body tissues. And to expand on the chemistry, but not go too far into cellular metabolism, I'm going to talk about why oxygen is so important. And oxygen is the terminal acceptor in the electron transport chain. And the electron transport chain is a series of electron transfers among cellular complexes, the end product being adenosine triphosphate. And as you know, adenosine triphosphate is the key energy supplier for our cellular processes. So moving on to the real-world implications of iron and anemia. In any healthy diet, iron must be incorporated. And there are two main types of dietary iron, heme and non-heme. Heme is bound to the hemoglobin and myoglobin of meat sources, and this includes poultry and fish. Approximately 50 to 60% of the total iron present in meat sources is in the form of heme iron. The other 40 to 50% is in the form of non-heme iron. Non-heme iron is also known as ferric iron, and it has a charge of +3, while the heme or ferric iron has a charge of +2. And if we go back to this slide, you can see that the integral part of the heme molecule is the ferrous iron, the iron +2. So heme iron is more readily bioavailable, and our bodies can use it the most efficiently. Non-heme iron needs to undergo a reduction reaction, and this reduction reaction takes place in the acidic medium of our gastric secretions. And the elemental iron found in total cereal needs to go an oxidation reaction, which also takes place in the acidic environment of our gastric secretions. So this, I'm going to talk about the absorption and excretion of iron by our bodies. Our bodies do a very poor job of absorbing iron regardless of its form, but we do a very good job of holding on to that iron. So surplus iron is stored in the liver, and iron is a micronutrient which can become toxic if ingested in too high of quantities. Some people who are at high risk for hepatotoxicity due to iron overload are individuals who suffer from alcoholism and who have undergone some other form of liver damage. Iron deficiency is a common form of anemia, so there are many individuals across the United States and the globe who revert to supplementation of their iron. Iron is most commonly supplemented in the form of ferrous sulfate, which supplies the ferrous Fe plus 2 form of iron. And this is important for people to pay attention to because iron can become toxic in high levels. Children are specifically at risk for iron overload. This iron overload is the most common form of pediatric overdose in the United States, according to Lutz, Mazur, and Litch. And it most often happens when children gain access to their mother's prenatal vitamins, because prenatal vitamins have exceptionally high iron content due to increased iron demand for fetal development. So why exactly is iron put into total cereal? And this goes to the idea of food fortification. Food fortification is the process by which manufacturers artificially add micronutrients to staple foods. It's a very cost-effective way to reach populations with the appropriate micronutrients, and its purpose is to prevent disease, promote healthy immune systems, and create a society that is healthy and functioning. There are 79 countries across the globe who have legal mandates requiring at least one staple food be fortified. These foods commonly are in the form of wheat grains, corn, maize, and rice, and oftentimes oils. There are global coalitions that have been formed to combat malnutrition, and fortification is one of their key weapons used against this. These include the United Nations Emergency Children's Fund, the World Health Organization, the Global Alliance for Improved Nutrition, and the American Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. So total cereal is actually fortified with over 16 micronutrients, and this includes 100% of the USDA's recommended daily allowance of iron. There are other common household items that are fortified, such as salt with iodine, which is a key micronutrient in thyroid health. And milk is also fortified with vitamin D, as well as vegetable oils being fortified with vitamins A and E. So to wrap up this presentation and put it into perspective of just how food fortification ties in with biochemistry, if we did not have dedicated biochemists understanding the chemical processes in our bodies, we would not possess the knowledge needed to promote health and wellness in our communities. So a key to understanding our health and health status across populations is understanding how our bodies process small chemical substances, molecules, or even elements such as iron. Thank you, and these are my references.